already on the screen.
Wonderful. Yeah. Okay.
So you want to use
it? There is also laser. Yeah.
Point to shoot
me somehow. Yeah.
Or
I already go forward. Yeah. Anyway. Okay. Thank you very much, Chair, and I would like to thank also the organizer for inviting me here in this very interesting conference, which is related to friction. So basically, we are here contact force, or basically lubricated one, is mostly similar to the case of my talk, which will be related to basically the non-equilibrium dynamics of microscale particles that are dispersed in a fluid. So now we are in the overdamped regime, low Reynolds number, basically, that are driven via a periodic potential, basically across an order, and then I will also show you some result about what happens on a disorder landscape, as the one that is shown in this image. So, my name is Pietro Tierno, I'm from the University of Barcelona, as the chair said. You are all welcome to visit me, basically. It's a very pleasant place. And most of the experiment, this is an experimental talk, has been pursued by a postdoc of mine, which is now in Switzerland. Ralph Stopp is the first author. But also, I strongly collaborate with theoreticians, and I will mention them during the course of this talk. So before, basically, the talk is switched in two parts. The first part is related to directional locking. I will tell you what it's about. And then the second part, how to deal with the case of disorder. But before going into the details, I will just briefly explain, basically, the main setup. So how do we travel these magnetic colloids? So here you see, let me stop the video, a real-time experimental video where you have a large collection of microscale particles. Their size is 1 micron, so here thermal fluctuations are important, but the magnetic interaction with the underlying substrate that you see with these parallel stripes, I will tell you just now what it is, this substrate, basically are so strong that these fluctuations somehow are relatively weak. And moreover, we can see these stripes because we have a special technique. We use polarization microscopy. This periodic potential is one-dimensional, periodic potential. I will tell you about two-dimensional soon. It creates basically a periodic potential, like a sinusoidal function, that translates at a constant speed. So the particles sit in the minima of this potential that are basically this very narrow region that separate two stripes of different colors. And we can use time-dependent field to move this sinus so that you basically are dragging the particles here. And this is real-time video. So as you can see, the particle can move. This is a one-dimensional traveling wave ratchet. So they move at constant speed. So this is basically fully ballistic movements. If you measure the mean square displacement, you have an exponent 2 in the power law. And then you can also invert the chirality of this rotating field to make this particle go backward. So this is a very powerful way to transport colloids with constant speed across this one-dimensional periodic potential. Then we will see what happens in a more complex case. Let me tell you a bit about the system. So we use basically single crystal, they are called garnet films, so they are basically thin films. They are transparent on naked eyes, but you can see basically that if you watch them under polarization microscopy, they reality show a very complex maze of stripes where basically if you take a cross-section of them, and here you have a schematic of a cross-section, the stripes are characterized by a fixed length scale, which is related to the thickness of the film itself. And the stripes are composed by magnetized domains that have opposite magnetization direction. And they are basically connected by a block wall, so where basically the magnetization vector rotates. Seems to be a bit a complicated setup, but in reality, you can generate on the surface, so we are using the stripe field, a very nice periodic potential that then you can manipulate to transport these colloids, one that you place on top of them. And in fact, let me tell you, for example, here, let me stop this video just a second. So basically, the idea is the following. We place this colloidal particle. The size is of the order of this length scale in this magnetic film, so this wavelength, on top of these films. So we here make a small polymer of a certain elevation of the order of 1 micron. The wavelength is of the order 2.6 microns, so this periodic potential. And then we apply a time-dependent field. So here you have the expression is a rotating magnetic field. So basically, they just perform a circularly polarized rotational motion along a certain direction. It has a chirality, like in this case, clockwise. Then you can easily change, basically, the direction of one of the two field components to invert the chirality, so make the particle going on the opposite direction. And what you realize is basically simple adiabatic transport mechanism. So in fact, if you plot the energy in this space-time plot, you see basically low energy corridors where a particle is trapped in one minima and follow the minima itself. So you can more easily see with this, this real-time video where basically I calculate the potential which is generated on the surface of this garnet films. As you can see, the potential is going up, down, but the minima are slowly translating at the constant speed. And the speed is, of course, proportional to the frequency of the driving field. So if you increase the frequency, the particles are transported faster, and so on. This is basically a traveling wave. Of course, if you move the sinusoidal function too fast, at some point, since the system is strongly overdamped, you lose the phase and you can jump backward. And so basically you start to desynchronize with the traveling wave. In fact, basically you can describe the synchronization process by using an Adler type equation. Okay, this is basically a one-dimensional system. The nice thing is that you can generate also two-dimensional structure, like lattices basically of magnetic bubbles. These are ferromagnetic domains that have all the same magnetization direction. So these are pointing upward, and they are immersed in a film of opposite magnetization direction. So you have basically a two-dimensional periodic potential where these cylindrical domains are arranged in such a way to form a triangular lattice. And this is because, basically, you can transform a stripe pattern, the one that I showed before, in this triangular lattice. And you can do all the same. You can apply this rotating field and make 1 micron colloids. Here are a bit larger, are 2.8 microns, moving across this, basically, two-dimensional lattice of cylindrical domains. Of course, you can change the direction of your rotating field, make the particle going up, down, so going all along the two-dimensional space. And if you measure the average flux, the colloidal flow, basically you have clearly two regimes, a synchronous regime where the particles are within the minima of your periodic potential, and they stay there. And then an asynchronous one, when you increase frequency, so you go too fast, the particle lose the phase with the traveling wave, and they just go backwards. So the average speed decreases, and you have a sharp transition between both of them. This can be easily described in terms of a synchronization process, okay? Now, related to basically friction, and I go to the first part of my talk, I will tell a bit about a phenomena which in colloidal science has been pioneered quite a bit of time ago with some experiment from David Greer, that is the question of directional locking. So the fact that when you have a periodic potential and the particles that enter with a certain force, for certain value of this force, which is not too high, the particle can lock its movement to a crystallographic axis. And in fact, this was beautifully shown 2002 with a real experiment by using holographic optical tweezer, where they have basically a particle that was driven by a flow, by a Poiseuille flow. So here you have a colloid, and the particle enter regions where you have a periodic potential, and they basically change the orientation of the periodic potential. And depending on that, of course, the particle can lock to a certain crystallographic direction, and you can even see a series of discrete plateau when you are basically plotting here the normalized velocity along a certain crystallographic axis with respect to the tangent of the angle theta. Theta is basically the angle between the direction of the particle and the X axis. So this is basically a phenomenon that occurs when you have a certain symmetry in the system and your driven system try to follow it. And then there have been also other very nice experiments. Sorry, maybe I'm going too fast. I mean, they were done basically in 2003, where they used this directional locking to sort different types of colloids, for example, of particles. So it's a way basically give rise also to technological application. Or quite recently, in the group of Clemens Bakinger, basically, we will hear a talk this afternoon on that. So we have also directional locking of a larger cluster made of colloids on top of a periodic substrate. So this is a very nice phenomena that has been explored basically at the single particle level or at the large cluster where you have effect of commensurability between basically the cluster and the underlying pattern. But I would say that not really recently, sometimes ago, but in 2008, there was an article where they showed the possibility also to have a collective directional locking. So the fact that not only at the level of individual particles, particles lock towards a crystallographic direction, but can be also that when you have a many-body system, so that where there are particles that repel each other, they can also even lock along a certain crystallographic direction. And also, a colleague of mine in Los Alamos, Charles Reichardt, they show with numerical simulation on a vortex system, which is similar, basically, to a colloidal one on the collective level, because these are also overdone particles. The interaction is a bit different than my microscopic level, but I will tell you just what is the phenomena. So they see that, basically, when they have an underlying pinning, which is here made by a non-econ pattern, and they have colloids, basically vortices, that strongly interact between each other, when they drive with a constant force, can be that for certain value of the force, basically, you can lock all the lattice along a certain direction. And you can even have vortices that slides upward or vortices that slides downward. And this basically appear as a bifurcation like in the velocity as a function of the driving force. Of course, then when you reach a critical value of the driving force, the pinning potential basically is unimportant and all particle flow along the driving direction. Okay? And this is basically due to a spontaneous symmetry breaking because if you perform again, this was numerical simulation, the simulation basically start again, the direction they choose, whatever it is upward or downward, is totally random in this case. Let me tell you that the lattice is oriented in such a way that the two main crystallographic directions are basically one, of course, perpendicular to the other, and they intersect the driving direction. So if you have directional locking, you either go up or you either go down, okay? And we try to do the same with our two-dimensional pattern of magnetic colloids. In fact, we get this triangular lattice, and we orient the triangular lattice in such a way that basically the driving direction exactly intercepts two crystallographic axes. In this case, we are driving the particles from right to left, and we have these two crystallographic axes, the green and the red one, so -1, 0, and 0, -1, that exactly basically are at the same distance respect to the direction of our driving. It's not a constant force, it's the direction of our rotating magnetic field which generates this kind of traveling wave. Of course, for a two-dimensional lattice of ferromagnetic bubbles, the two-dimensional periodic potential is a bit more complicated than the previous case. So here you have a time sequence, basically, of a magnetostatic calculation of this two-dimensional periodic potential that show, depending, this is one field period, depending on the orientation of the applied field, you can have that the energy minima, which are basically in the color red, they are either at the center of the magnetic bubbles, or they can appear in the interstitial regions. So this is taking into account, basically summing up the field of all the bubbles that are like disk in a uniform magnetized periodic potential. I will give you more details, of course, if you are interested, during the coffee break. This is no problem. But nevertheless, during one period of the rotating field, a particle that is initially placed here, basically at the center of a bubble, so can go, basically here there should be, this is invert, but let me tell you, that is initially placed here, then basically because this image should go here, it's okay. Then there are six minima that appear at the interstitial region, while the central region become an energy, basically is energetically higher. So the colloids have two choices. Either it can go upward or can go downward. And then it can end up at the end in one of the two bubbles that are basically nearest neighbor. So it can either go upward or downward. So now you have a real-time video of when we are driving these magnetic colloids across a large area of this two-dimensional periodic potential of bubbles. As you can see, at the level of single particles, the particles just perform random excursion along the transversal direction. So in average, they have a constant speed along the X direction, so from basically right to left, but randomly they can either go up or either go down because small thermal fluctuation can decide which of these two routes can be basically undertaken by the driven colloids. But what do we find out, and this is related to this collective directional locking, is that when increase the density, the amount of particle within the observation area, so we observe the following case. Sometimes the particle form clusters, and this cluster, because the time average interaction are a bit attractive, so this cluster tend to polarize along a certain crystallographic axis. While individual particles, you can see here, they perform a random excursion either up or either down, trains of colloids either go up or either go down. So they can basically become polarized and they choose to lock along one crystallographic direction. And in fact, since these are colloids, basically we can use simple optical microscopy to basically extract all the relevant degree of freedom, basically the particle position, and extract all the physics. You can calculate everything there. And in fact, as you can see, when you increase the density, this phenomenon becomes more and more evident. So let me tell you, for example, here is the trajectory of one colloid along a certain time periods that perform randomly upward and downward. And then downstairs, there is a trajectory of a particles in a large cluster that just is polarized along the upward direction. And effectively, we change the density. Basically, we measure the trajectory. We find out that if we plot the velocity, the average velocity of our collection of colloids, as a function of the density of the system, we find this bifurcation-like cluster is not where, which is due to this spontaneous symmetric breaking. So here we have branches, velocity that go upward along the positive direction. So we are now driving the colloids. Let me tell you, we are driving the colloids from right to left. So we have here in blue, as a blue scatter data, the average velocity along the driving direction, which is negative as it should be. And then as a black point, basically experimental data of the driving direction along the transversal direction, basically perpendicular to the driving one, which can be either positive or negative, depending whether the colloidal trains are polarized along the upward direction or downward direction. And we see basically that both situations occur. And this is due to a spontaneous dynamical symmetry breaking. If I stop the field, repeat the experiment, my colloidal trends can either go downwards or upward. Doesn't matter. This basically depends of small disorder present in the system on thermal fluctuation. Of course, when you increase the density at some point, when you reach a very high dense system, so the particles now are in a cage, they have a lot of nearest neighbors, they cannot polarize anymore. It all basically, this become a moving solid that just move at constant speed. So the longitudinal velocity becomes zero and it just move along basically the driving direction, okay? So with this, basically, just tell you briefly that one can break this symmetric situation by applying a constant bias field along one direction, which make basically one direction preferred respect to the other, as it is shown here, basically. You can find more information on this work in this recent publication that appeared and was done in collaboration with Arthur Straube, in Berlin, that is a theoretician that allow us also to understand this time averaging magnetic interaction. So with this, I basically finished the first part of my talk. I tell you a bit more about disorder system, that it's more complex, but also more similar to real life cases. So we find out a way basically to disorder this periodic lattice of this triangular lattice of bubbles. So it's an experimental trick that is basically based on changing a bit the way we create this pattern by using high frequency magnetic field. But at the end, we can create an exotic-like phases where basically we have a series of crystalline domains of bubbles, but they are basically they are separated by grain boundaries that enclose different crystallographic directions. So we can introduce in our system a controlled degree of randomness, of disorder. In fact, we can characterize by using all the standard basically tools, which are like calculating the pair correlation function or the bond correlation function, that is basically the orientation of the six neighbors in a plaquette with respect to the nearest one. And actually, we find out that the phase looked like an exotic one. No, now, for example, people expert in exotic system would say, okay, but your system is nevertheless relatively finite. You need a quite larger length scale to be able to infer the exponent. I totally agree, but nevertheless, it's a way that we use to characterize the degree of randomness in the system, which is basically the fact that this bond correlation function that you have it here decays algebraically in this disorder case with a certain exponent that we use to characterize the degree of randomness. Of course, if it's totally flat, we have a perfect crystal, a defect-free, as the one on this image here. On the other hand, if it starts to decay, but not basically become not exponential one, like in a liquid case, so we have an exotic-like structure. Now, on a disorder system, situations start to become also a bit more complicated. Still, you have these trains, but the trains do not polarize anymore because, of course, they can encounter these grain boundaries, get trapped there, or again, they can get destroyed close to this grain boundary. So we measure, let me, how long time I'm still left? 5 minutes. So, okay, with discussion, so we'll try to speed up. Okay, thanks. So basically, we measure the average speed of our magnetic colloid as a function of the normalized density, and we find basically two surprising features. The first one is that we drive our colloids now in the asynchronous regime, so the frequency is very fast. So we find that as we increase density, they speed up, there is a speed up effect, and then there is a slowdown at very high density, which is due to a disorder-induced jamming. It's an effect that is due to the disorder itself. Let me tell you just that basically we can explain, we have a model, this system, by using a simplified model. This work has been done in collaboration with Dominic Lips and Philip Maas at Osnabrück University. And I will skip this because of the time constraint. Nevertheless, there is the following. At some point, we were able to explain the speed-up effect, and in order to explain also the disorder-induced jamming, we switch The totally different type of modeling is there to take brute force, take the interaction, this complex magnetic interaction, the Doppler interaction, hydrodynamics, and so on. We just switch to a lattice gas model where we assign certain probability to the particle to jump and a certain probability to the particles, once they become cluster, to move faster with respect to their neighbors. Okay, so we perform Monte Carlo simulation, and the nice thing that is this relatively simple lattice gas model is able to capture very well the experimental data. Actually, you can see here that we have as a scattered data, basically the normalized flux of the average speed, normalized flux on the left, average speed on the right, of our colloids as a function of the density, so increasing density, increasing interaction, particles see each other and so on, with the continuous line, this lattice gas model that is obtained from Monte Carlo simulation. So I won't stay more because I would like to have also questions from the audience. Let me tell you that there are different future directions that we are exploring. I would like to thank many collaborators that help us to understand from the theoretical side this work, and the funding agency, and especially you for the attention. And we'll be really happy to take all your questions.
The nice lecture. Thank you for your nice talk. So in the last part, it was a bit quick for me. So eta 6 is the exponent for the bond orientation order decay, right?
Yeah.
Why is it normally you have a range from 0.05 to 0.6. How do you manage this? How do you control eta 6?
Okay, we basically different experiments, different field, different field that we apply to prepare the field. So we somehow control the way that we go from a very order to a disorder one. So we track the position of the bubbles before making the colloids of that, and we calculate the bond orientational order, basically. And we find out
really in a controlled way. So you can really say arbitrary exponent you can. Is that what you said?
We did some experiment. We find this exponent, and okay, it's a bit the other way around. But I mean, Peter came also can do
it's,
it.
It's amazing that it's changing such a lot.
Yeah, we can change it a lot, but there is also the things that our system is not huge, so this can be also debated. That then at the end, this become you know.
To the